right, so Hare Krishna to all the participants of today's program. Please accept my humble obeisances. Vancha kalpataru bhayascha kripa sindhu bevacha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha ananta koti vaishnavrinda ki jai shila prabhupada ki jai. So thank you so much for joining us today for this seminar on secret to healthy relationships. मुखं करोति वाचालं पंगुं लंगायते गिरं यत्कृपातमहं वंदे श्री गुरुदीनतारिणं परमानंदमाधवं कृष्णचैतन्यईश्वरं ओम अज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय अपने अपने गुरुदेव की जय. So thank you so much for inviting me on your channel today, and we'll be discussing a very very interesting topic on how to have healthy relationships. The goal of our life is to go back to Krishna. The goal of our life is to go back home, back to Godhead. And for the same, we are trying to establish, or rather I will use the word, we are trying to revive our relationship with Krishna. So we have a relationship with Krishna, which is a vertical relationship. And then we also have relationships in this society, which is the social relationship, you know, the horizontal relationship, which we have with our family, friends, and relatives. Now, the whole point is, for a person to be happily situated, he needs to harmonize his vertical relationship and his horizontal relationship, because even if you have, let's say, very good vertical relation or strong relation with Krishna, you need to have harmonious horizontal relation, otherwise it will hamper your spiritual growth. Because you can't grow in your relationship with Krishna unless and until you have a happy horizontal relationship. Otherwise it will hamper your smooth progress in Krishna consciousness. So that is why we have chosen this topic today to discuss, is how to have healthy horizontal relationships so that we can grow in our Krishna consciousness. Now, relationships by itself are very complex, because relationships, there are emotions involved, you know. See, for example, today if I give you, let's say, 10 stones, and I ask you that you have to manage these 10 stones, you'll tell me it's very simple. Just have to manage some 10 stones. They're all dead matters. If I keep those 10 stones lying there in a room and I come back after 10 years, also those stones will be lying there only. There's nothing big thing about it. So if I ask you to manage 10 stones, you can manage it. If I ask you to manage 10 machines, then it's a little difficult, but okay, you will manage. You have to oil them, grease them, you will manage. If I ask you to manage 10 mouths, then it's a little difficult, because now the life is involved. The moment the life comes into picture, then things get a little complicated. And if I ask you to manage 10 babies, then you are in trouble. Because now what will happen? A new story will begin. You have to take care of the babies, feed the babies, then you give them lots of love and affection, and then the baby gives you, you know, the baby responds, and now lots of questions in your mind. Does the baby understand that I'm caring, I'm taking care of the baby? Does the baby know my name? Does the baby know that I'm serving? Does the baby love me? Oh, so many questions will come in your mind. So it's easy to manage some stone or some non-living things, but the moment you are managing life, then the whole complication starts, because you are dealing with emotions. Relationships are full of emotions. So that is why we need to deal with this subject matter very carefully. So today, we will discuss a particular pastime from Srimad Bhagavatam. And then we will try to see what are the relationship principles that we can draw from this particular pastime. Of course, Srimad Bhagavatam as such has so many wonderful pastimes and so much matter. But what we will be taking today is what matters to us and what way we can utilize the lessons from that past times in our day-to-day life. So this is a very, there is a very big pastime, which I'm going to tell you in very short and just take the important lessons. So this comes in Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 4. And this pastime is about the Daksha Yajna. So now the pastime start like this. Daksha has organized a very big yajna, very grand yajna. And he's a big man, you know, Prajapati Daksha. And the whole arena is full of people and demigods, and even Brahma is there and Lord Shiva is there and everybody's assembled. And so usually when a big man, you know, he's, even though it's a religious function, but it's also like of a social event, because according to the hierarchy, people's seats are being placed and they've been worshipped and feet washed and given proper places. Now, usually what happens when a big man is hosting a party, he won't be standing in the gate and welcoming. Usually he'll have his assistants and subordinates do that, and then he finally enters. Something like, you know, if you are invited to a party to the Rashtrapati Bhavan by the president, oh, everybody will be assembled and then he will enter. So everybody is assembled in the arena, and you know, the fire sacrifice is about to start, all the arrangements have been made, and then Daksha enters. And the moment Daksha enters, everybody gets up, you know, like welcoming him. But two people don't get up, and that is Lord Brahma and Shiva. Now Brahma doesn't get up, Daksha doesn't feel bad about it, because Brahma is a father, you know, Brahma has created Prajapatis. So he's okay with that. But Shiva doesn't get up, and he feels a little bad about it. He feels very bad about it, actually, because he's thinking, you know, what an audacity. He's my son-in-law, you know, and I'm entering, and how come he's not, you know, getting up? So he feels very offended. So immediately he starts criticizing and blaspheming Shiva. He says, you know, all the people assembled here, I just want to tell you, I'm not bothered about my respect or honor. I just want to tell you that how a civilized person is supposed to behave. A civilized person is supposed to know whom to respect, what to do, how to behave. But even though I entered this arena, Shiva did not get up. That shows that how uncivilized he is. And he starts blaspheming Shiva here and there. So many things. You can read that chapter and so many things he'll say. So then Shiva just walks away. Now, the underlying or the principle that we can, of relationships that we can learn from this pastime. There's a disharmony in relation between the son-in-law and father-in-law, right? And now why did this happen? Why did this happen? Because Daksha is looking at the relationship with a different dimension. He's thinking, Shiva is my son-in-law, he's supposed to get up. But Shiva is looking at the relationship in a different dimension. Actually, Lord Shiva does not need to get up, because Lord Shiva, Brahma, Vishnu, they are the primeval lords. So they are actually senior to Daksha. They don't have to get up or show any respect to Daksha. Anyway, that was not there in Shiva's mind. Shiva is meditating on Vasudev. So he's not even thinking about, oh, I have to get up or something like that. He's completely in his own transcendental status. But still, for Shiva, it's not a big thing. Okay, what happens if I don't get up, somebody enters, what's the big thing? But for Daksha, it's a very big thing. So now what happens? Why is there a disharmony in any relationship? Because different people have different need. Different people have different need. The need for Daksha was to be respected. He thought, I organized such a nice yajna, so grand, and my own son-in-law did not respect me. He's feeling bad about it, because that is his need. So sometimes in relationships, this is what happens. We have a particular need. Maybe the other partner does not understand our need, and that is where the problem happens. Now, why is there a difference between needs, or why can't we understand other person's need, is because people sometimes are dealing with different currency. Let me give you an example. Let's say she gave me one very nice gift or something nice which is of value, So I'll think, Hare, she gave me so nice thing. Maybe I should give her $100. She'll feel happy. But maybe she does not know the value of dollar. She's from India. She knows only rupees. So she may feel, I gave so nice thing to Mataji. At least she should have given me 1,000 rupees. But she just gave me $100. Now the problem is, $100 is actually more than 1,000 rupees. It's more than 7,000 rupees. But she does not know what is the value of dollar. So now I'm thinking, this does not have even 1,000 rupees value, but I gave $100, I gave so much money. It is not even $10 cost, but I gave so much. So I'm thinking I did my best. But she is thinking that it is at least 1,000 rupees she should have given, but she gave me only $100. Now what is happening? We both are dealing in different currency. She doesn't know the value of my currency and I don't know the value of her currency. This is what is happening in relationships. And that is where the disharmony happens, right? Let's say, for example, a father and son. The father loves his son and the son loves his father. So now the father thinks, maybe I should buy the most expensive bat for my son, most expensive ball for my son, so that when he plays cricket, he'll feel a pride. I have the best brand ball and the bat. But the son may feel, I don't want best quality bat, I don't want best quality ball. I just want my father should sit in the stadium and watch when I am playing match against this particular team. So now for him, his need is the presence of his father in the stadium. And now the father thinks, if I can give him the best things, and for that maybe I can't sit in the stadium and watch his match because I have to attend meeting, I have to attend office so that I can earn more money so that I can gift him the best things. Now he is thinking in a different way. His need is different. This is what happens with all of us in our relationships. Our needs are different. Now the question may arise, if our needs are different and the other person's needs are different, how do I know, Mataji, what is that person's need? So you have to observe. How do you observe? Just see what the person is always talking about. What is that is making that person upset? For example, sometimes, even between husband and wife, sometimes the wife will say, in 1975, when we attended my brother's, cousin's, brother's, sister's, daughter's marriage, you behaved like that. And I felt so bad about it. Now you may think, that happened in 75, 77. Why is she talking about it now? That means that was very important for her. So now you understand that is her need. Now let's say there's some things which your wife appreciates about you. The moment you do that, she's like, oh, that was very nice of you. So now you understand, okay, this is her need. If I do this, that makes her happy. If this is what she wants. And that way we understand other person's need. Okay, now this is about other person's need. What about my need? I have some need. So how do I let other person know what is my need? So you communicate with the person. You talk with the person. Yeah, this is my need, right? When you communicate, if you do this, I'll feel that you care for me. If you do this, I'll feel happy. So when you communicate and then you know each other's need, then you can have harmony in relationship. So here the need for Daksha was he wanted respect and he didn't get it. So he felt bad. So he started criticizing and he started getting angry and he started blaspheming Shiva. And what did Lord Shiva do? He just left that place. Now, that's another thing. When somebody is angry, how do you deal with that anger? Of course, there is no standard procedure. It's only dynamic equations. Sometimes when a person gets angry, the best thing is to leave that place. Because when you leave that place, after some time, the person who is angry will become cool and then he will think in a proper way. But sometimes, if you just leave, that may make person more angry. Aray, this doesn't even care. I'm getting angry. The person is leaving. What is this? But sometimes you have to sit. You have to sit and patiently listen. What is going on? And then slowly. But whatever, whether you leave, you don't leave, the whole point is you make sure that you sort it out. Because what happens if you don't sort it out? Some minor issues are very small. Over the time, it'll heal and everything will be fine. But some issues are so deep, they will leave a scar, they will leave the wound. And then what will happen if you don't sort it out? See, just like in the mud, if you put some seed, after some time sprout will come out. Similarly, anger, when it is buried, then frustration. When anger is buried, then hatred will come out. And when hatred comes out, then what will happen? Then what that person will do is, he will take those old issues and will hit on you when it hurts you most. I get this lots of email from different couples, you know. They'll say, you know, Mataji, my wife takes out some issue which is so old, you know, but every time she'll remind me of that. Or sometimes the husbands or Prabhus say, oh, my wife takes out, or sometimes the wives say, my husband takes out those issues. Something that is already over, you can't do anything about it. You cannot change the past. But with every future interaction, those past things he will go on bringing. So why is that happening is because you didn't sort it out. If you sort it out, it's over. But if you don't sort it out, then see, in relationships, especially in close relationships, you become an expert scorekeeper. You write down scores. You did like this that time, you did that, you did that, you did that. You write down very nicely. So you become excellent scorekeepers of each other. And then you'll keep reminding each other of what happened then and what happened when. So the whole point is how to deal when somebody is angry. So the whole point is don't run away. And if at all you, even if you have gone away from that particular situation just to make the person calm, after some times also, at least you should sit and communicate and sort it out and not allow it to be buried. Otherwise, afterwards, so many problems may come out if it has not been clarified. So here what happens with Lord Shiva, he just leaves the place because he sees there is no point of talking to Daksha. Daksha is in a very angry mood, right? Anger is hot-headed, hot-blooded. Anger is hot-blooded and hatred is cold-blooded, you know. So he's very impulsive at that time, so he just leaves. Now what happens? After some times, again Daksha organizes another grand yagya. He invites everybody, but he does not invite Shiva and his wife. So one day Parvati is sitting in, you know, at Kailash, and she's seeing, oh, so many nice planes are going. Where are they all going? So much activity happening in the sky, you know, all the nice denizens, you know, celestial denizens, demigods with their wives, they're all going. So where are they going? So Lord Shiva says, well, your father has organized another yajna and they're all going there. So she says, really? Then I must also go. Let's go. We'll also go. So then Shiva says, look, we have not been invited. So then Sati is like, that's all right. He's my father. Even if he doesn't invite me, I can go. So then Shiva says, look, it's not correct. You remember what happened last time. So even if he's your father, if he has not invited, better not to go. And then, this is very interesting. You can read this chapter in Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 4, and the whole discussion starts between husband and wife. Now Parvati, she becomes a little upset. Why is Shiva behaving like this? Why is Shiva talking like this? Why is he restricting me to meet my family members? Now what happens here? You see the human nature. Of course, Lord Shiva and Parvati are exalted, but these are just for us to take principles, take lessons. So now, you know, this is a human nature for us also. If we want to do something, we have a desire to do something, and if somebody stops us, then what will happen? That person may be stopping us for our own protection, but we feel this is restriction. Why so many restrictions? It's not restriction, it's just protection. But you are looking at it as restriction. Just like in the number 6, you know. If I look, I feel it is 6. If you look, you'll say it is 9. Because your side of looking is different, my perception is different, your perception is different. Now this is another problem which is there in relationships. You know, understand others' perception. Now Lord Shiva is telling for the good of Parvati. But Parvati feels, though, this is not correct. Why is he not allowing me to mix with my family? So understanding others' perception. We have to understand what is the other person feeling. So see, you see with the children, suppose if the parents will say, don't play beyond this fence. Then the child may feel, I'm restricted. Because for the child, playing outside the fence is fun. For the parent, playing outside the fence is danger. So the father or the mother is perceiving it as danger. the child is perceiving is that fun. That is why there is controversy. That is why there is a problem. There is a difference in perception. So, what's the solution? I remember of one very real life incident. I'll tell you, this happened in one of the devotee whom I am dealing with on a regular basis. He's a psychiatrist. And so many times he shares so many interesting cases with me. So he was telling me one day, he said, Mataji, you know what happened? One child came to my clinic. The parents said that we are seeing a lot of change in our child last 1 month. The child is behaving like a terrorist. Then he asked, why, what happened? He said, some kind of a violent behavior. Okay, what did the child do violent? No, my daughter is very much interested in painting. But nowadays, she paints the waterfalls red, the trees red, the flowers red, the fruits red, the river as red, the monkey as red, everything red. I don't know what kind of, you know, violent feeling she's getting. So he said, all right, bring her, I'll talk to her. Small girl, 12-year-old. So then this man, you know, is speaking to her, that, so how are you? You like to paint? Yes, uncle, I like to paint. So I said that, you know, what you are doing nowadays, show me your painting. So yes, all red paintings. So the psychiatrist asks, Ari, the water is not red, it's blue. How come you have painted it red? And the girl said, uncle, last 1 month, my sharpener is missing, uncle. See, all the color pencils now, they are blunt. Only the red color pencil is sharp one. So I'm painting with that red color because sharpener is missing. I'm not getting it. I don't know where I kept it. That was the problem. If she gets her sharpener, she'll sharp the pencils and she'll paint it. But she's having only red color. So she's painting everything red. Now what the parents are thinking, oh, my child has become violent. Why is painting red waterfalls, red colors? That's the problem. Our perception, you know, this is a problem. So this is one principle we have to understand in life, is understanding the other person's perception. And to make the other person understand our perception. So what should I do? I should communicate. I should let the other person know what's my intention. See, today if I tell somebody, hey, don't walk there. Now for that person, why shouldn't I walk, Mataji? It's nice green grass. No, but there is a ditch below that grass which I can see, which you can't. So I should communicate with you. Now, what I should do is, sometimes what I'm able to see, you are not able to see. So I should give you my spectacles. Okay, here is my spectacles. Now look at it. Can you see the ditch? That is why I'm asking you not to walk. So you communicate your intention, right? And when you are not able to understand the other person's perception, ask, question. I couldn't understand why you asked me to do this, or why shouldn't I do this, or why shouldn't I go? Just discuss, just talk. The solution will come. Instead of keeping in your mind and then making hundreds of unnecessary thoughts, this must have happened, that must have happened, this must be the reason. Just be simple person. Keep it simple. Ask. I could not understand why you asked me to do this. It's over. Matter is over. So, you know, Parvati gets all upset, you know, Are, why is he behaving like this? I want to go to my parents' house. He's not allowing me to go. Okay, anyway, she did not listen to Shiva. She went. She left. Now, when Parvati left and she was there in Daksha's yagya, nobody looked at her. Nobody's talking to her. Her mother was nice to her. Sisters were talking. But father completely ignored her as if she does not exist. He does not talk to her, does not even look at her. She feels very bad. Usually our human psychology is, sometimes silence is a bigger killer. Sometimes you are okay if your enemies are hurling harsh words on you. You're okay. That's better than your close friend not talking to you. If somebody just ignores you, doesn't even look at you, you feel very hurt. Or she feels very hurt that, why like that? Now the situation is, though it's a crowded place, thousands of demigods with their wives are there, but she's feeling lonely, right? Why? Because she's feeling unwanted, and that feeling is so bad. In any relationship, people want to be wanted. Is it not? Everybody in this world, you want that somebody should want me. I should be important. I should be needed. Is it not? You see, that is why even Lord Shri Krishna, he's omnipotent. He doesn't need anything from anybody. still, you know, he will behave with Yashoda Mata. I'm hungry, can you give me some food? Or he will tell Gopikas, oh, Radharani, where were you? I'm missing you. Oh, Lalita, where are you? I want this. No, Lord doesn't want anything. But if he says, I want this, I need this, then what happens? They become so happy. Yes, I'm also important in this relationship. So even in this material social relation, everybody wants to be wanted. Today, if you are not wanted in any relationship, you feel very morose, right? That is why you see in the materialistic world, they have this love you card, miss you cards, you know, so many cards. Why? Because everybody wants, oh, somebody should miss me. Somebody should love me. I'm wanted. I'm important in this relationship. If you are not needed, then you feel very morose. Nobody needs me, right? So now she feels very morose. Nobody needs me. My father is not even looking at me. What to do? And she's at present in the most vulnerable situation. Why? Because she left her husband, argued with her husband, fought with him without telling him and talking. She just came. And now when she is here, even father is not behaving properly. So she feels very bad. Now this is another principle in relationship. When somebody is vulnerable, we have to give more affection. We have to be more nice to that person. Not that we take advantage of that situation and we exploit. See, usually people in this world, they will not share with you their weakness unless you are very close to the person. They trust you. Then only they'll tell you, this is my problem, this is my weakness. So what you can do if you want this relationship to become strong, then you should not take advantage or laugh at their weakness. You have to cover their weakness. You have to cover their vulnerability and you have to support each other, right? But if you see, like, let's say, a husband knows a wife's weakness, or let's say a wife knows a husband's weakness. Let's say he has a weakness that he can't do fasting. He has to eat, you know, even if it's Ekadashi, he wants all varieties. Now imagine that's his, this is maybe one of the weakness. And now imagine the wife will take that weakness and all the time point it. You know, anything he'll say, you don't talk. You even on Ekadashi, you want to take Sagudana Khichdi, this, that, you never fast. You don't talk. Even on Ekadashi, you want to eat. Now what will happen? That is his weakness. But if you go on piercing that weakness and hit at him and hit at him when it hurts, then you can't have a good relationship. Good relationship is you know each other's weakness and you try to help each other. You don't hurt them, right? But this is what happened here. She's in a weak position. Husband is not there along with her. And she's already feeling bad. And not only is she insulted, even there is no seat for her husband. Usually during the yagya, fire sacrifice, even if the demigod does not come, they have a particular seat for him. She sees there is no seat for my husband, no respect for me. Why am I treated like that? So she feels very bad. So one more principle that we learn, apart from the first principle that I spoke about, is understanding other person's need, understanding other person's perception and understanding other person's vulnerability and then helping them, supporting them, not hurting them. She feels very bad. So then she decides, okay, I'll give up my body. So she goes and sits in a mystic position, closes her eyes, and now she's ready to burn her body. That means self-immolation, that means suicide. Now everybody who was there in this arena, when they saw her sitting, they understood what she's ready to do. Now, Daksha is also, he's an intelligent man. He understands what she's doing. But he does not stop her. And that is so sad. Even if we're walking on the road, if we see a stranger also is trying to commit suicide, we'll stop. Hey, don't do that. What are you doing? Why are you jumping off the, you know, off the river? What are you doing? Why are you trying to? But own daughter, and he does not say anything. He just watches her, what she's doing. And she's just going to die. She's going to, you know, burn herself. Now, why did he do that? Why did he do that? Oh, he's very detached? No. He's very attached. What is he attached to? He is attached to his own feelings. What is those feelings? He's feeling very bad that Shiva had insulted me and now I insult his wife and I get even with him. So now what has happened? Daksha is rude to that, you know, Dakshayani or to Sati is not because he has anything to do with the Sati or anything to do with her. Actually, he's rude to her because he's putting her in a different frame. So that means usually when people are directing their action towards us, they may be directing their action towards us, but it may not necessarily be because of us personally. they may be simply putting us in a particular frame, in a particular category, and they are against that. Now let me explain to you what I'm trying to say. So now for Daksha, now Sati is not his daughter. For Daksha, now Sati is Shiva's wife. And Shiva had insulted him previously. So now by insulting his wife, he is getting even with Shiva. He has forgotten. So now what he has done is, he has put Dakshayani in a different frame. So usually when people also behave with us or deal with us, the thing is they have put us in a different frame. So they're not personally actually doing anything to us. They are against that frame or category in which they have put us. To give you one mundane example, you know, a couple of years ago, I was counseling one lady from Hyderabad. And she came with the complaint. She said, Mataji, my husband is always very suspicious about me. You know, he'll say, don't talk to this person. Don't look at this person. Don't talk to any men. Or maybe this person is your friend. Maybe that person is looking at you. So possessive about her. And, you know, at a point that she was like frustrated, you know, I'm so chaste to my husband. I'm so loyal. What to speak about, you know, having any other person in my life, even in my dream or mind also, I don't think about anybody. You know, and her husband is behaving in such a way. So she wrote a letter to me and I told her. I said, he's not having anything personally to you. Basically, there is some experience that he has gone through. And that is why he has put you in a particular frame, in a particular category, nothing against you personally. So after a long conversation and long letter exchange, she wrote back to me. She said, Mataji, you are right. You are right. I said, his brother-in-law, my husband's brother-in-law in America, you know, he had a very bad marriage life where his wife had left him, you know, got married to somebody else, and they had a bad time and divorce and all. So now what happened? Because of that experience, that incident that happened with his brother, now he's also putting me in that category, putting me in that frame. You know, oh, something must happen, something will happen. Maybe my wife will, what will happen? I have to be very protective. I have to be very possessive about her. This is what happened. So nothing personally to her. But just that he has put her in that frame. He has put her in that category. You understand? So it may happen with us also. Sometimes we are not at all at fault. We haven't done anything wrong. But the person puts us in that frame. It will happen. How do you deal with that? When such a thing happens to you, how do you deal with that? When somebody is talking negative about you, saying something about you, which is completely not true. Of course, if somebody is doing that, there are many ways you can actually go and communicate with that person, you know, look, I'm not like this, or you confront with the person, or you, you know, or you ignore the person. In Kali Yuga, the best thing is ignoring, just ignore the person. Of course, you can do that when it is something to do with, you know, far off, not related to your day-to-day life, but if this is something which is happening in your day-to-day life, then it's a little difficult, right? But sometimes you have to forgive. Even if it's not your fault, you know, you have to forgive. See, I'll tell you, there's something called right beyond the right. Right beyond the right. Sometimes the right action comes in between or comes in the way of the right purpose. You see, in Srimad Bhagavatam, there's another pastime of Prithu Maharaj. Prithu Maharaj was doing yagya, and Indra was disturbing his yagya, the 100th yagya. He was changing his forms, and he was stealing the horse. So then Brahma comes and tells Prithu, don't do the yagya, leave it, stop it. And Prithu agrees. And then Lord Vishnu becomes so happy because Prithu compromised, and then he comes and blesses Prithu Maharaj. Now, if you see here, frankly, there is no mistake of Prithu Maharaj. Prithu Maharaj has not done anything wrong. But still, he was the one who compromised. He was the one who gave it up, right? So, you may say that, you know, the right action would have been that Prithu Maharaj should punish Indra for what he is doing. Because Indra is the one who is feeling insecure. Prithu has not done anything wrong. But the purpose of Prithu Maharaj is to please Krishna. So now, this right action is coming in way of his right purpose. So what he did, he left the right action. He did not punish Indra. He just forgave him. Because for him, purpose is very important, and that purpose is to please Krishna. And even be without doing the yagya, Prithu Maharaj was able to please Krishna, so his purpose is over. So like that, so many situations will come in your life where you're not wrong. You haven't done anything wrong. But then you'll have to forgive. You'll have to forgive. So you have to compromise, right? So here we are talking about this husband and wife. So because of his suspicious nature. But sometimes, you know what happens? This lady has done nothing wrong. But then her husband is going on, you know, saying so many things and so suspicious about her. Now, at one point, she may feel like, oh my God, you know, she may go into depression. Am I really like that? Is my behavior really like that? Why is he treating me like that? So, thus situations will come in your life. So what do you do during those kind of tough situations? If your vertical relationship with Krishna is strong, then when this kind of turbulences come in your horizontal relationships, then you can withstand it. That means you have to remain connected to Krishna. If you are connected to Krishna by your Shravanam, Kirtanam, talking about Krishna, thinking about Krishna, hearing about Krishna, speaking about Krishna, memorizing verses, chanting bhajan, taking Krishna prasad, doing seva, associating with devotees, then this will give you a lot of strength to endure situations in your life. Our relationship, you know, ship with Krishna is the ship which has an anchor. Krishna is our anchor. A ship which is in the harbor with an anchor, even if the waves are turbulent, very strong, and they hit the ship, nothing will happen to the ship because the ship has an anchor. Like that in our life also, there will be waves of ups and downs, waves of respect and disrespect, waves of loneliness. But if our ship, relationship is anchored with Krishna, then we can withstand all kinds of situations. So this is a takeaway lesson from today's class. Of course, relationship by itself is such a huge subject, which we can't do justice in a couple of minutes or an hour. Can go on and on, because in our day-to-day life we have to deal with so many different kind of people. There are some people whom we like to deal, we're very happy to deal with them. Just talking to them is a joy, you know. When they talk, you feel so inspired in Krishna consciousness. Even in our day-to-day community, ISKCON community life, there may be so many such devotees where you feel sheltered. When you just talk to them, you are inspired. Every talk that comes out, you feel, oh, I want to do more service for Krishna. It's a pleasure. And then there are some devotees, you have working relations with them. You know, okay, I mean, you have to go with them. Okay, you just stick to your seva and then slowly you develop relationship. But there are some devotees, working with them is troublesome. Every day working with them is like a walking in a mine, don't know what will explode when. But there are different varieties of devotees you have to deal with in your day-to-day life. But when you take shelter of Krishna, then you can deal with all. Your relationship with other devotees will become more mature when you take shelter of Krishna. So that's a takeaway lesson for today's class. You should understand others' needs, understand others' perception, understand others' vulnerability and help them, and take shelter of Krishna. Take shelter of Krishna, right? And that will give us strength to endure the different dynamics of the different relationship situations that we face in our day-to-day life with different people. And our vertical relationship is not a substitute to our horizontal relationship. Both have to be harmonized. Then we can grow in our Krishna consciousness. Right? So with this, I'll end it here and I'll open the floor for any questions, if any. Thank you so much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Hare Krishna. Okay, so I understand the question that there are so many needs for a person which may not be useful to grow in bhakti, and again you can't satisfy everybody, so what to do? Yeah, you cannot satisfy anybody in this world. You cannot be perfect housewife, perfect mother, perfect wife, perfect daughter-in-law. You can only be reasonably good, in this world, even Krishna could not satisfy. You know, they could see fault even in Krishna. Shishupal also saw 100 faults in Krishna. So people around us, you'll never get a certificate that you are a perfect person with no fault. Always there'll be some or the other need and desire that of the other person which we can't fulfill. But we have to see which needs are, you know, important, and which needs, if not fulfilled, will hamper our Krishna conscious progress also. Now, of course, your question is very general, and you know, I cannot. There are customized answer for different situations. So you are your own judge. So you see what kind of need that is, and what is the best way or reasonable way that you can fulfill, how important it is, and if you don't fulfill it, how much it will hamper your relationships. Or sometimes something maybe that can be negligible, but then there are some times which you need to harmonize. You have to harmonize, otherwise it will disturb your progress in Krishna consciousness. Like, I don't know what your question is aimed at, but sometimes I get questions like, my spouse is not Krishna conscious, and my spouse wants that I should go for a movie with him or her. So what should I do? So how, that is his need. So what should I do? How do I satisfy? And that's not good for my Krishna consciousness. You know, that kind of questions come sometimes. So yeah, it'll happen. So you have to, you know, you have to negotiate. You have to negotiate. You have to come on the negotiation table. And you have to negotiate. This is what you do for him, and this is what he does for you. And then you make a common ground. You make a common ground, and you discuss and sort it out. And that is a way, slowly, because you can't be very, you know, we understand that most important thing for us in this world is to get our relationship with Krishna right, and, you know, progress in that direction. But the problem is, this is all luggage that we have accumulated from our previous lives. If we don't satisfy them and completely ignore them, then also it's a problem, because then you'll have to go on taking birth and satisfy their needs. So there are certain duties which we have to do, because we have been put into this position, put into this situation. But then all said and done, for everything there is some way out. And most foremost is, you know, bhakti is so accessible. It's not that, you know, you can always chant. Like I've seen some Matajis, they'll say that, I'm not allowed to chant, my mother-in-law doesn't like it if I take a mala and sit, you know. Because their family, they are not devotees. So I told her, okay, do it with clicker. She said, no, not with the clicker also. She'll not like it if she sees it. Then I said, okay, do it with your finger. So like that, for everything, where there is a will, there is a way. You can always take out some, you know, reasons. But that lady who was speaking to me, she was very much like, oh, I'm so unfortunate. I cannot take a mala bag. Oh, I cannot take a counting bead. I cannot. I said, don't worry. Your stage is like the gopis. The gopis were also restricted from going to Krishna, meet Krishna, or talk about Krishna. But they remembered Krishna in their heart. And then that made her a little happy. And she was like, ah, yeah, even the gopis were put in that kind of problem. So, yeah. So like that, there will be so many different kinds of situations. We are in this material world. And remember, whatever situation that you are facing now with your family members, it's, you must have done something in your previous life also, which is bringing so many obstacles in your Krishna conscious life. So there's no point in running away from that. You just accept it. Yeah. So some things are of your previous life situations, and some situations you have created by your own behavior. Sometimes if we start behaving like, you know, we are pure devotees, and if we demonize the other spouse because he's not so Krishna conscious, and we make him feel like a villain, then he feels very bad about it. You know, so see, I'm not particularly saying anything to you, and in general I'm talking, because your question is general. So I'm just telling you the various questions that come to me, and this is what I have realized. So you should not demonize the other person also just because they may not have Krishna conscious desires. And their desire may be materialistic, so you don't demonize them. You know, I'm pure devotee and you have such low desires. No, that's not the way we deal with them. Now, this is what I'm talking when one spouse is Krishna conscious and the other is not. Now, let's say sometimes your spouse is also Krishna conscious. You are also Krishna conscious. Both are initiated devotees. But his level or her level may be different. And sometimes you are just not able to match with each other. Then what should I do? then in those situations you should count your blessings. You should count what are the good things, what are the nice things that he is allowing you to do, or she is allowing you to do, or she is cooperating with you. And all said and done, we have to remember one thing. In this world, there are billions and billions of people who are not Krishna conscious. Out of that, there are only a handful of people who are Krishna conscious. And you are fortunate to have somebody in your life who is Krishna conscious. So whatever may be his nature, at least he is looking towards Krishna. And you are also towards Krishna. And so you should be very happy and grateful that you have somebody who believes in Krishna and who is also chanting, and you are also chanting. And you are so fortunate to have his association. So that is one thing we can think. And the other way of looking at it is, everybody in this world is struggling, is it not, with their mind and senses. We are also struggling. Maybe our struggle may be in some different category, and his struggle may be in some different direction, but everybody is struggling. Nobody is perfect and nobody is pure devotee. He is also struggling, she is also struggling, I am also struggling. We all are struggling. So we all are struggling, so we should have sympathy for each other. And that's all right. That's all right. He's trying and I'm also trying. So like that, we have to make best out of whatever situation we are put in. See, surrender to Krishna does not mean that, oh, I should have all best situations in my life. Surrender means whatever situation Krishna has put me in, I'll make best out of that situation without complaint, and I'll be grateful. Whatever situation Krishna has put me in, I accept that situation, and inside the boundary of that situation, whatever I can do best my Krishna consciousness, that's happy. See, just like when you put a question like this, I understand, okay, that what situation you must be passing through. I'm just a normal human being, but I still understand. But Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, so he definitely understands what is your situation. And he definitely understands what is your situation and what best you are trying to do in your situation, and he will appreciate you. So you'll be happy about it. Don't worry so much. Krishna understands very well. So whatever situation you are put in by the Lord's arrangement, accept it, be grateful, and whatever possible in that limited boundary, try to do. All said and done, we here as individuals should be very careful in not hurting others, and trying our best to harmonize our relationships with everybody in whatever way possible. Our philosophy should be to give more than expected. Then we can be successful in life. If we can keep this one mantra, I want to give more than expected. I want to give more than what I receive. If you can use this one mantra in your life, no complaint. That person reciprocate, doesn't reciprocate, I'm so nice to him, he is not nice. I want to give more than I receive. I want to give more than expected. If you can follow this one mantra in your life, because you see, we are temporary anyway. We just have to go back. Somehow we are passing our time. That's our destination. Here we are on the way. So many people will meet us on the way. Don't take them so seriously. Don't take them so seriously. That's why I like this one line. Matter does not matter. Matter does not matter. Don't worry so much about this world. Nothing is going to matter. When you're going to reach your destination, all these small hurdles that you faced, all obstacles that you will face, you'll forget about it. Imagine, you faced a lot of problems on your way to Mayapur, Car got punctured, tire was punctured, and driver was not driving properly, and there was no water available, and so much difficulties you faced. But finally, when you go and stand in front of Radha Madhav, you forget everything. Oh, all that problem that you had faced in your journey, you'll forget. So similarly, when we'll finally reach there, all these things will become so that's it. So keep your focus, I'm going to go there, and, Krishna's going to appreciate me if I, sacrifice, and at the end, everything's going to be nice. That's it. And with that thing in your mind, just, keep going. I just hope this answer helps you.
Thank you so much, Madhuji. There's one another question. how can we solve the problem if we have done something unintentionally but it has done a lot of damage?
You have done something unintentionally and it has caused a lot of damage. If the damage is irrevocable, it's all right, but you can always ask forgiveness to that person and you can express, you know, when you sincerely feel bad, oh, I shouldn't have done that, what you call paschatap, when you are seriously lamenting, then, you know, from lot of karma you will be relieved. When you sincerely, genuinely feeling bad about, you know, what you have done unintentionally, that also relieves you from so much karma. So if you have intentionally hurt some devotee or somebody, go and ask for forgiveness. And if it's not devotee but a particular situation or something, whatever you have, you just lament about it. If that devotee is not available, you ask forgiveness to Guru and Krishna, and that should be fine. Because sometimes it happens, you know, so we are human, and to err is human. Sometimes we may make some mistakes, but when the moment we come to know about it, we can be vocal about it, talk about it, communicate, ask forgiveness and move ahead. Should not go into depression and feel very bad about it, okay, because it was not your intention. So that's all right. Okay. Any other questions?
Yes, Mataji, there's one more question. Hare Krishna, Mataji, what should we do if a temple authority has a problem with us and uses every opportunity or platform to try to make derogatory comments against us or put us in a spot purposely in order to turn other devotees against us?
Okay. So your question is, what if a temple authority is against us and making derogatory comments about us, so what do we do? Okay, so there are three ways. First is you go and communicate. You tell them, Prabhu, this is what I came to know. So have I made any mistake? Did I offend you anyway? Have I done anything wrong? Can you please guide me? Since you use the word authority, they are your authority, you can always be humble. So where did I make a mistake? Can I do anything? Can I rectify myself anywhere? Am I making any mistake? Please let me know. Go and communicate. Even after your regular continuous communication also, if they are not responding, so the other way of doing it is, you communicate with other devotees whom you feel are important for you. Oh, they may misunderstand me. Actually, I'm not like that, but they may think like that about me. So you can, to your close people, you can communicate and clarify. So one thing is you communicate with the authority. Second thing is clarify with people who are important for you that, look, I actually have not done like this. Or you can just tell them your version of the story. You know, see, in this, every event or every story has three versions. One is your version, one is my version, one is the right version, you know. So like that, you just tell your version. This is what happened on that particular day, this is what happened, and let the other person decide. Then the other person may tell you, no, but actually I heard from authority this happened. Then you can clarify, no, Prabhu, actually that was not my intention, this is what happened. Third thing is ignore, and that's the best thing to do. If you can ignore, because in Kali Yuga, people's memory is very short. Today you are the hot gossip, they'll talk about you. After some time, some new gossip will come, they'll forget you and they'll talk about that. And that will go on and on. So if you can ignore it, just ignore it. If you can't, clarify it. If you can, communicate. Speak with the temple authorities and clarify with them. And ask them humbly, what way I can change my behavior, what way I'm, you know, causing any disturbance, please let me know. I'll try to rectify myself. And if all this thing also doesn't work, then pray to Krishna and leave it on Krishna and take it as a positive thing. It's okay. Maybe Krishna wants me to be more humble. Even though I haven't done this, but I'm getting these negative comments, maybe it's my previous karma, maybe I must have done something wrong. Maybe just leave it on Krishna and pray to him. If nothing works. See, at the same time, I don't advocate inactivity, putting everything on destiny. This is my previous life karma, this is my previous life karma, this is my, so I will not do anything. No. Previous life karma word comes into mind when you become completely helpless, when nothing is working. You tried, but nothing is working, and you still keep trying. But at the same time, you also convince your mind, okay, not everything is in my hand, you know, you can just surrender to Krishna, pray to Krishna. Maybe this is for my purification. Maybe by this, Krishna wants me to be more humble. even though I haven't done this, I'm getting that blame or something. Maybe Krishna wants me to be more humble. So you take it that way. You take it that way. What is that sloka? Brahma's prayer. Tatte nukampa susamikshamano bhunjana evatmakritam vipakam. What is that Brahma's prayer? Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, Chapter 14, Sloka number 8. What Brahma tells to Krishna, your devotees, tattenu kampa susamikshamano. They just tolerate. Those who are devotees, the most beautiful thing about, you know, abhushana, alankara, the beauty of a devotee is the tolerance. A devotee means he'll tolerate. Just tolerate, that's it, you know, what can be done? Certain situations are not in our hands. But Krishna says that if you tolerate, then I like you. And if you want to be liked by Krishna, then you tolerate. Sometimes you have to tolerate. No, I'm not saying don't try, don't misunderstand me. I'm telling you, try, whatever way is possible, doesn't work, take it as Krishna's mercy and tolerate. Titikshava Karunika, what it says in Srimad Bhagavatam, the quality of a devotee. Titikshava Karunika is compassionate. You know, he's tolerant. So that is what it is, right? Okay, one more question and then we will end.
Hare Krishna Maharaji, the next question is, as we have come to know that pure love does not exist in this material world, how important are horizontal relationships?
Yeah, pure love does not exist in this world, but those people who are around you, you cannot ignore them, because you cannot isolate yourself, you know, from this world. You are living in this world. So when you have harmonious relationship with people around you, then it will help you in your Krishna consciousness. Imagine you have people around you, if you don't have happy relationships, then you can't do your japa properly. Just had a fight with your wife, you know, very bad fight, and she threw something on you and you throw something on her, and then you say, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, how can you chant Hare Krishna? How so many things will go on in your mind about her, right? You have problem with your in-laws, you have problem with your children, you have problem with your finance, everything is required, right? Then how will you do your japa? How will you do your seva? So everything is playing an important role. Since we are there in this material world, we can't isolate ourselves, right? Unless and until you decide to take sannyas, go and stay in forest, there also you'll get problem. There also, you know, you become a sannyasi also, you're in the forest. What happened to that fellow? I'm forgetting his. I think it was Ravan. Yeah, no, Hiranyakashipu. Hiranyakashipu, when he went to the forest to meditate, and he got irritated by two birds, because those birds were chanting Narayan, Narayan, Narayan. So he got angry and he came home and he's telling his wife Kayadu, I don't want to go back to that forest. Then what happened, my dear husband? Oh no, those two birds, they're saying Narayan, Narayan, Narayan. I'm getting so irritated. So he came back, you know, and then after some time, of course, Kayadu conceives, and then he again goes back to the forest. So the whole point is, this whole world is full of, you know, that kind of people. So we need to make some changes inside us so that we can harmonize the outside of us. And if everything is in harmony, then we'll be able to do our Krishna conscious activity, the process, peacefully. So everything is important, you know, it's all part of the game, right? So you have to manage both, you know, then you can go smoothly back home, back to Godhead. Okay.
Hare Krishna Mataji, there's one last question, that's fine.
Okay, last one.
Okay, Mataji. The question is that if husband is already married and he killed his first child and second wife and her parents, and if this one adjusted herself and also husband is behaving accordingly,
has hidden his marriage. Okay, this looks like a personal question. Maybe I can just answer it one to one. Maybe you can just mail to me and I'll answer it for you. Okay? Okay?
Yes, Sab Krishna, Krishna, Krishna lage. Sab Krishna, Krishna, Krishna lage, sab Krishna.